Okay, so this is the kind of bottom plank lamination, all kind of thickness down, and to check it's all kind of even thickness. I've just got a calipers, vernier calipers, and I've just calipered on all four corners, and it reads 6.55 millimeters on yep. All four corners. 6.5. So yeah, 6.5 plus minus 0.1 millimeters, all four corners. That should be just fine. Now I'm gonna leave this to sit, and because this rosewood is actually the grain isn't particularly straight. And being a rosewood, it's quite prone, especially in a flat sawn and configuration. It's quite prone to movement. And I've taken a relatively large amount of wood off from both faces, so this could move over time. So I'm going to leave this for, a couple of days in the room, just to leave it to stabilize and move as it will, and then I'll come back and clean it up. As I need to remove any kind of twisting and warping and stuff. So this is kind of done for now. And I'm not gonna trim this to width quite yet because I'm gonna wait for it to finish moving, trim it, leave it again to move for if it needs to move, and then I'll do the lamination and marking out and stuff. So that is gonna go aside. Now, next thing we can do is well, you need a jig for pairing the sort of the mouth area of your plane, and this is one I made. There's a 71 degree angle here. This is for the wear, what's called the wear, basically the part of the kanna, basically the front throat mouth kind of area. This is roughly about 70, or maybe about 65 to 75, somewhere between that range. The narrower it is, the harder it is for the shavings to come out, but you'll get a tighter mouth over the life of the sole. Whereas if it's a higher angle, like the 75 end, then basically you'll have more room for the shavings to come out, so it's less likely to jam. However, your mouth is more prone to opening up more as you take away the kind of, as you go to reflatten the sole, you take away material, and as you do that over time, the mouth will open up faster than if it was a smaller angle. So I've chosen 71. I actually aimed for 70, but as I made this jig, it ended up being 71, and luckily on the internet I found other people using 71 for some random reason. So I thought, okay, I'll just stick with 71. So that kind of turned out good for me. That's just 71 degree angle there. The other side is a 39 degree angle. Now this is my, for this particular plane, it's a 39 degree I measured for the blade setting angle. And I measured that off this front surface. Don't measure off the bed because this is not the kind of cutting angle. It's this front wedge angle here. I measured that to be 39. Usually it's either 38, 40, that kind of area for a standard setup of a kanna. So measure yours and basically, create this jig. It's basically just a square block of hardwood with these two angles, and I've just made sure this face, the bottom reference kind of face, is flat and square to one edge, and along that reference edge, I've just glued a piece of, in this case, beech. And you can see, yeah, I've just put that on so it acts as a stop, so it can sit against the side of whatever I'm trying to pair, and I can clamp that down, and it will give me a good guide to pair with. So yeah, making this jig is pretty easy. I did this all by hand, no machines, whatever. So you just have to take your time with a plane to make sure this angle is perfectly flat, as in you take a square and you take that off your reference edge and make sure it's properly square across here, and also the angle is consistent along here, along the face. And if you take care and do that, you should be able to get a nice clean angle for your jig. excuse me. So the next thing with this jig we can do while the lamination piece is drying out is, most likely on your die, these two kind of blade sort of mortise front angles here, they're probably not in line and they're probably not perfectly cut because they're cut by saw by hand, and they may not be perfectly in line in the same plane as each other. They're probably roughly the same, but they're most likely not exact. So we're going to clean that up, hopefully, you know, make that as exact as possible. So we've got this jig referenced up against one of our edges. I'm just going to clamp that down. And basically I have to clamp this down just behind the most sort of, I don't know what you call it, the rearmost angle, the one that needs most paring. And basically I've just got a long chisel and I'm just going to slowly pare that down. You can see, or probably hear, I've got quite a bit of material to remove. So I'm just going to pare that away. And so take one shaving, check to see what it's like, and yep, I've taken so this is what I've taken off, you can see in that one pass. Basically you just keep doing that, inching back until you get both in the same sort of plane, just pair left and right as you need to, and that will ensure that when we go to laminate our piece on, mark out our mouth and stuff, it'll make our life a lot easier because then we can make sure everything is square, whereas now it might be slightly off square and you'd have to adjust for that when you mark onto your lamination piece, and it's just basically a pain in the ass. So take care of this now and you'll have an easier time later. This isn't a problem doing it like this because with your lamination piece, if you've made that lamination piece thick enough, you'll actually have enough room to adjust, because usually if you do this, you end up with a mortise which is too loose for your blade. But because we're laminating a chunk on the bottom, we'll actually create some more room to pare away this bed area. And, you know, that will close up any gaps that you created doing this shaving here. So, yeah, it's not a problem. So I'm just going to keep doing that. Finish off cleaning up this, and then I'll guess I'll come back in a couple of days and cut down that lamination piece to size. Here is the body die ready with the lamination piece. Now this has all been kind of cleaned up and you can see I've already cut this to width. As I said earlier, I actually left this for a few days after I'd thicknessed it. Then I kind of cleaned it up a bit more after it moved. Then I chopped down the width to rough width. It's not exact, there's still about maybe 2 millimeters, it's 2 millimeters wider than it needs to be, but then I kind of, you know, cut it to width and then left it. The important thing is that I made one reference edge and that was square to my my lamination face, which is this face, so this is square. And this is straight. Now, once I did that, then I made this edge also parallel to this other edge. So that, and this is also square to the top face. This is because then I can get my my angle pairing jig and I can reference it off either side and still get good results. If I didn't do that, basically I could only reference it off the reference edge. Otherwise I'd get, you know, skewed mouth and all sorts of problems. So do that. Now, once you've done that and kind of cleaned it up and everything, You want to determine the orientation of this sole plank. Now, you first want to make a mark on your lamination face, basically the face which will be laminating onto your die like that, so make some sort of mark. And you'd also want to orient the plank so that the grain is running in the same direction as the plane is moving when you're pulling it to take shaving. So mine's this orientation, but I'm going to be pulling it like this, and the grain is running like this along the board. It's not quite that exaggerated, but it's like kind of, you know, running in that direction. So when I pull, it's not, the grain isn't digging into the work. If I did it this way, then it would kind of be rough. It's a minor detail, but it's something you should keep in mind when you are cutting any kind of plane body, actually. So make sure it's in the right direction, facing the right way, and basically just mark on your top face and also on either the front or the back of this piece, you know, something to indicate the orientation so that when you go to glue it up, you don't have any problems. Also, when you're marking as well, you don't have any problems, you know, finding out which way you kind of had it when you did all that marking and stuff. Now, we're going to set this aside because for this particular plane, I have to do one extra step. Now, normally, when you have this plank is, I think, I can't remember actually, 6.5 millimeters or something like that, so 1/4 of an inch. But usually with a plank that's about 5-6 millimeters thick, you should have enough material here to bulk up the sole and provide enough extra material so that you can cut away the bed, etc. Now, this particular plane has a problem in that basically one of these ramps here for the blade, they were too, one of them was too kind of far out of plane with the other one, so I had to do quite a bit of pairing in one of them, and basically that meant that my mortise was, it just became too loose. So basically this is what happened. If I put the blade in now, so give it a tap so it's rough, kind of working-ish, you know, tension, and basically this is the kind of fit I'm getting. Now you can see this, the blade is protruded way further than my plank will allow. So I'm going to end up with basically a mouth which is too wide. Now that kind of defeats the whole purpose of this exercise. So instead of, well, one solution is to get a thicker piece for the sole, bulk it up so that it's past the protrusion of this blade, and, you know, do all the cutting, etc. If you do that, though, you basically move the mouth forward. You can see now, this is the rough line of where the mouth is. So somewhere here-ish. So on this line is where the mouth is going to end up if I do the current, you know, lamination and then cut the mouth line, etc. Now this is pretty much near the middle of the plane body, and that's not really ideal. You want this to be kind of, you know, a bit further back. So basically the more you laminate on, the further forward your mouth will creep, and you don't really want that, because obviously your mouth is going to end up too far forward and your plane won't feel right. So I'm going to stick with this thickness of lamination. However, to fix the mortise, to fix the mortise being too loose, I'm going to bulk up the bed here with some extra material. Now, as I said, you usually don't have to do this, because when you laminate that 5-6 millimeters on, you actually should have material to remove here to be able to get the blade to come out. But in this particular case, I have to bulk this bed up. So for this particular plane, I have to do one extra step, and that is to clean up this bed area. Now, I've just got this Iwasaki fine float here, and I'm just going to be running across the bed area, taking, you know, finish shavings. And my aim is to basically get a nice flat surface going this way, but I want to get a nice smooth, it doesn't have to be flat across here, you can have a gentle curve. Obviously it can't be too much because you won't be able to bend your lamination around, but the main thing I'm aiming for is a nice smooth surface. Also, I'm going to pay attention to when I do these undersides here, these kind of this area next to the mortise. I want to make sure that's clean and crisp, so I'm going to be getting a chisel in there and cleaning that up. And once I get that all flattened out, I'm just going to take this, this is a piece of sort of, I guess, veneer you'd call it, it's 2 millimeter thick Macassar ebony sheet. I'm just going to take a chunk out of here and laminate that onto there. Now I will show you that just because it could be beneficial to someone, but and for completion. But as I said, you don't usually have to you know, fiddle around with this area. So I'm just keep going here, get this nice and smooth. The other problem with having too thick for lamination on the sole is that this pin will sort of change position in relation to your blade. Now, if you imagine you had a super thick sole and you had to kind of make your blade sit, you know, really far down, like this far, say, you can see maybe your pin will basically ride further and further up your blade, because you obviously have to tap this further down into the die. And if you do that, basically with your chip breaker on here like this, ideally you want the pin to be somewhere around the middle of your chip breaker pressing down here. But if you actually, you know, advance this too far, your pin's gonna go further and further up your chip breaker, and basically it's not going to hold it as well as it should. So that's the other reason to avoid laminating too thick of a chunk onto your sole. So you know, if you find yourself needing to laminate too much, then the best option is to basically stop at about 5-6 millimeters thickness for the lamination, and stick some extra material onto the bed here. So I'm just going to finish cleaning this up. And when I've done that, I'll come back and I'll show you the lamination. The bed is now nice and flat, and while I was basically filing this down, I checked the flatness along the bed this way, using it's just a little shim of wood here. I made one edge straight. I made it thin so it could fit under this pin, and also to some extent into this mortise wedge area. And basically I just laid this down as like a straight edge, checking along here to make sure it was flat in this direction. Then I basically just worked on smoothing this curve out so there's no kind of weird lumps across here. So now this is a nice gentle curve, and it's, you know, it's nice and smooth. After that I just got some pair chisels and cleaned up this very corner of the mortise next to the wall so that I could fit my shim in. Now this is the sheet of ebony that I cut out. This just fits nice and easily. I trimmed it so that there's not too much poking out on the top and bottom, and I checked the fit by just kind of pressing with finger pressure making sure that this can, with a bit of pressure, sit flat onto the bed. Check also down here, the mouth, and you know, make sure that the width is sufficient to basically cover the width of your mortise in here. So now it's time to glue that down. I'm going to use fish glue. Basically, the procedure is to spread glue on here, a little bit on your shim as well, put it in, and I've got some paper. Well, it doesn't have to be paper, but it could be any sort of like string or twine or something. Get a good length of this, and basically I'm just going to put my shim in there in position with the glue in, and use this to tie it down to the bed to kind of like give it pressure as a clamp. Obviously, because this is, you know, angled and stuff, there's not much room here, you're not going to be able to get any traditional clamping done in there. So I'm going to use the string wrap just to get some clamping pressure down. So I'm just going to spread some glue onto my shim. You don't need a lot of glue. If you have a lot of glue, you're just going to end up squeezing it all out and creating a mess inside the mortise, which will be a pain to clean up. You don't have to use fish glue, but the reason I use fish glue is because it is reversible. You can remove it using a bit of heat and a bit of moisture, so it's nice and easy to use. And if you need to remove this later on in the life of this plane, then you know, you can do so. So I'm just going to spread this as well as I can. So there's enough glue on there now, and I'm going to take this, put this in there, slide that into position, and to provide a bit of extra clamping pressure in this mouth area, I'm just going to use a bit of cardboard folded up, and basically I'm just going to wrap this round and round. Basically just keep wrapping and kind of pulling and get a good even wrap, especially around these two ends under the mortises, and you should get a good clean joint. You can see I've trimmed the bottom here where it's protruding outside of the mouth of the block plane. Just flush that up with the sole so it's nice and flat now. And the top I've also kind of trimmed roughly to size, and that was done with the block plane. But to get it really close, I'm just going to take a chisel and sort of pare that down to the top surface. Just basically slowly pare that away until you get flush. Eventually I may actually just kind of take the block plane anyway and just remove that, removing some of this original kind of patina, as you'd call it. You know, depending on if you want to leave that or not, you can use a chisel, or you can just take a block plane and just remove the whole lot. Now, in the previous video, just prior to this, I basically used the kind of string twine to clamp this piece down. But I actually, while I was doing that, I actually came up with a better idea. And I was doing this with twine for like a while now, but it kind of came to me because I had the little shim I was using to check for flatness. This is actually wedge-shaped, and I basically got the idea of, well, instead of using string to clamp this down, why don't I just make a bunch of wedges to kind of basically tap down in here, because you have a perfectly good wedge-shaped mortise here. So what I did was basically take a few pieces of this. This is actually hinoki, so it's like Japanese cypress or something like that. But basically I had this sheet of, you know, it's about 6 millimeters thick, this kind of scrap laying around. I basically split off strips and roughly planed them to a wedge shape to fit, and I just tapped these down in these mortises, one here, one here and a couple in the middle. So I used the pin as the kind of the wedge surface, and that made a really good job of pinching this down tight to the bed. So if you're doing this, then I'd recommend you look into the wedging system, because it's quick and it works great. Now it's time to mark out the throat area onto your lamination piece. So I've got my lamination piece here, and it's in the proper orientation. Make sure it is in the correct orientation, and I'm just going to reference my reference edge and the side of my piece here, so that they're flush on the bottom. This is a piece of plywood here, so it's a flat surface, and so this is now together. And I've just got a mark here to denote this is how my pieces come together. I've just drawn two pencil marks here so that I can put this back in the same sort of position. Now, once I've done that, carefully put that down and hold, and I'm just going to clamp this down so that it doesn't move while I'm marking. Let's get this over. Okay. It doesn't have to be clamped down super, super tight, but just enough so that it doesn't kind of budge accidentally, so you nudge it. Make sure it is still nice and flush. Just feel it. Feels good. Maybe this bit, a little bit there. Okay, that's nice and flush, and your marks are still in the same place. Now, you want to mark all the surfaces of this mortise. So I've got a scribe here. It's a very sharp pointed, I think it's for machinists or something, for metal. But you want something like this, because obviously a pencil is going to be too fat to get into there. And you want a good clean line so that you can, you know, pair to. So I'm just going to get this and scribe along this bed area. Kind of awkward with the camera, and the important parts are the front surface of this kind of ramp as it hits the bottom. So make sure that's marked. It's actually quite hard to get in there because it's quite a steep angle, low angle rather. So I'm just going to mark that as well as I can. These are all kind of rough guidelines, so they don't have to be absolutely perfect, because when you go to pair this piece out, you can, you know, place it back and forth as necessary, and you won't be pairing to the absolute perfect size anyway, so you'll glue it on and then finish pairing. So this isn't too critical, but do try to make it, you know, as good as possible. Also, you want to mark out these side walls here. There's not much left of them, so it's kind of hard. This front area isn't so critical, because you'll be pretty much recutting that, and you may actually just cut into it anyway. So mark that. And also, if you can, mark the width of the actual blade mortise here as well. So once you've done that, you can unclamp and I don't know if you can actually see, but you probably can't, you see sort of a faint lines there where I've scribed. And so now the front kind of mortise area, let's get a pencil so I can mark it for you. I'm just going to find it. Okay, so it's roughly here. You want to get a square off your reference edge and kind of define that a bit better. So I'll use a pencil, I guess, actually. So that's my kind of ramp. Now, this can be shifted back and forth a bit, but this is your reference, and you don't want to go too far back and forth, because obviously you will run out of material on your lamination piece. Now, once you've marked that's kind of across, you want to get your kind of bevel gauge. gauge set at your correct angle. In my case, it's 39 degrees. I'm just going to mark that. It's kind of hard to see. Mark that there, and here. Okay, so I've got the, make sure it's in the correct orientation, as in it's, you know, sloping this way. And after you've done that, off your reference edge again, you just square that across the bottom. So this is now your mouth line, this squared line on the bottom. And these should roughly meet in the same place on both edges. They don't quite, because my marking is a bit off, but no matter. You want to take this reference mouth line as your basic, your reference, and the mark here on your reference edge as your other reference face. So these two are always going to be your reference now. So after this, you want to basically measure about a few millimeters, so it doesn't have to be exact, but like say 5 millimeters or so back from this line. And this is going to be your tsutsumi kind of ledge line. Don't make it too thin, because then it makes it really hard to pair under here. So make it of decent size. Don't make it too big, because then it makes, you know, having the ledge basically useless. You won't have a ledge in the end, basically. So about 5-6 millimeters is about right. You can just eyeball this. Now, when you've done that, you want to take a chisel and just get rid of this. Basically, you want to kind of pair along the tsutsumi line straight down. Kind of make a small indentation along this line. Actually, before you do that, even measure your width of your mortise in here. Now that's 12 millimeters. And about 13 millimeters. So I'm going to mark that here roughly. These don't have to be exact, because again, you'll be fine-tuning this when you've glued this down. So just make it so that you don't chop too far into the So I'm just going to give that a good generous extra millimeter or so on either side. And so these are now going to be your boundary lines. And sorry if I get in the way of the camera, but I want to keep away from that line. Put my chisel in and make it a vertical series of cuts. You obviously don't want to go too deep, because you really can't in something this hard. You just want to get a line to work to. And when you've done that, you just basically slowly pare that little chip away. And continue doing this. Continue paring this kind of, these chips away, going down at an angle until you get close to this front mouth line. And once you get within about a millimeter of that line, kind of stop, because then we'll go to the paring jig. And you'll use the paring jig at the 39 degree angle to pare that straight down in, so that'll give you your mouth line to basically tweak later. So I'm just going to keep doing that until I dig all the way down. Actually, no, you don't want to go all the way down. Go until they meet. Because this is 39 degrees, you probably won't actually be able to go all the way through. So before you go all the way through, because you kind of have to keep this area in check, kind of, you know, only go so far as to make them meet. And it should be roughly in the middle. When you've done that, we can turn it over and then do the other
side. Mouth here is a rough cut, and I'm a little bit away from my marking line for my mouth. Now, we want to chop from the other side. So on your reference edge, I set my bevel square to 71 degrees, which is the angle of my the wear, which is the front of the throat. And I've basically marked that angle on there from the mouth line up, and I've drawn that across here. And that's this front line you can maybe make out here. This is our kind of initial, from when you did the scribing, that was just a rough kind of mark. And this line should be pretty close to that mark. Mine is about 1 millimeter off, but it doesn't really matter how far off. It's just you want to pair on the inside of that newly marked line. So from here, you want to chop again straight down. And from the kind of the back of the bed where you scribed, move inwards about 1 or 2 millimeters just to be safe. And from there, you want to chop at a very shallow angle towards that front mouth area. And that should get you through and connect up the hole from the other side. Now, we are still chopping within the kind of the mouth width here. So we're still chopping within this width. We don't want to chop to full width yet, because we're going to saw these out, hopefully. So leave that width alone. So we're only chopping for the mouth. And again, sorry if my hand is in the way. Try to get it out of the way. But so chop straight down. Again, just chop straight across. And you know, define the front line. And I'm going to chop in from here. I should just turn this around. From this end, I'm just gonna pair out little pieces like this at a low angle. The reason we're doing this at a low angle and not the full kind of like, say, 39 degrees or whatever, is because we want to not chop too far so that we keep the enough material to make the tsutsumi ledge. So I'm only just gonna chop enough to break through to the other side of the hole, basically. And then from there, we can use the pairing jig to get more accurate results.